message of the gospel is that God declares us righteous while we are still actually unrighteous in ourselves.
Then there is no sin we can commit that will cancel or negate the power
Jesus,
of his
I
death.
Believe in you. He said, all of your sins, past, present, and future, are thrown into the sea of forgetfulness.
By the righteousness of Lord Jesus Christ, God looks at us and he doesn't see us within the context of our sin.
Not God's seeing a righteousness in us that we have done, that he may have helped us do, but rather, could it be that
they are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them.
Means that there is an alien righteousness.
We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For ye are not under the law, but under grace. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. For to be carnally minded is death. Pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, because it is written, Be ye holy, for I am holy. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Walk as children of light. Hereby know we the spirit of truth, the spirit of error. That after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls.
Hebrews 3:14. For we have become partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. What I want to talk about is the perseverance of the saints. Or the old language for your Calvinistic doctrine of election. It stood as code for eternal security back in the 1800s. What we're going to focus in on is the evangelist Charles Finney and show how on one side of the coin he preached a holiness doctrine that sounded like he was preaching conditional security and meeting the conditions of salvation and repentance and obedience. But on the other side, he preached perseverance of the saints. And we can prove it here. That's what we're going to do. So we want to point out that the spirit of error, as we've pointed out in many of our videos, has been hard at work for centuries in the church, twisting and polluting the word of God in the system. So much of this deception then comes through a means that you don't expect, through your own pastors and teachers and the theologians, people that expound on the scriptures. They piece together scriptures. You can take this scripture and that scripture and this scripture. So like I said before, you can just about prove anything you want in the scriptures. You can prove that the sky is green if you want to in the scriptures. If you piece together different verses to prove some doctrinal position, that then it translates into the study materials and the books and the training manuals, and it gets preached in your church as gospel to you. And that's pretty much where the deception lies. So if we investigate, Charles Finney was an 1800 evangelist. He was a revival evangelist that got saved in, I believe, the Presbyterian churches as a youth, and then came across into the Lord, began preaching the Word of God. He was his background was in law, so he was college educated at the time, and he had a very sharp and analytical mind. He rejected the doctrine of original sin and preached repentance and obedience to the faith. And he thundered against sin and unrighteousness, which shocked the system of his day. Shocked it to its knees. I mean, you read accounts of those revivals and many people were moved. But we'll give some of our reasons why we think those things may have happened and may have occurred. Many today still consider Finney a heretic. If you look him up on the internet, you'll find many people, because he rejected original sin, He's still considered a heretic, but other people that despise this cheap and easy gospel that's being preached everywhere, and there seems to be a bunch and a growing number of those people, they hold him in high regard, and they're convinced that he was a holiness preacher, because maybe they've never read his lectures on perseverance and election, perhaps they haven't, but they're certainly out there on the websites. So they're convinced that he preached a holiness-based message based on conditional security, but that is not the case with Charles Finney. I don't care what quotes you can send me to show me, well, you're only justified as far as you obey God. I know he said those things, but he doesn't mean it in the way you think he means it. Because those that are justified will persevere. Remember, you don't think David lost his salvation. And he thinks Saul was never saved to begin with. So he has to, see, because he makes that statement in his lectures on election. He makes the statement that no saint ever fell into eternal ruin. So therefore, David could not have fallen into a ruin. In that, at least in that 9 month period where he did not repent before Nathan came to him after the adultery and murder. He didn't forfeit his salvation, even though what scripture says, that type of thing won't inherit the kingdom. But nevertheless, that's what he taught. So when he says that you're only justified as far as you obey God, it sounds good. It sounds like he's saying the right thing, but really he's keeping one leg on either side of the fence. As I always show on my board, you know, the difference between the Gospels. So he's keeping his leg on both sides. He pleases both sides by that. One side, they know he's preaching election. So he's not going back on perseverance of the saint. They will persevere. See, based on his passage in John 6:26. See, based on that passage, they'll endure. He says, "For as the Father has given them to me, I says I won't lose one." Or six. Chapter 6. But nevertheless, we'll get to those scriptures. So anyway, if you examine his lectures, you find that he contended for election, predestination, perseverance of the saints. So theologically, Finney would be numbered among the Calvinistic doctrines, maybe kind of a lukewarm cave, in that he rejected the original sin, the depravity thing. So he discarded the absolutes and talked about the necessity of obedience and the evidence of the faith had to be there and all that kind of thing. And like I said, the original sin was out the window with him, but yet he still held to some of the other tenets. So the great difficulty in exposing Mr. Finney is the perception that people have if when they listen or they read his sermons. I had the same thing before I understood that these lectures on election and everything else. See, when they published his books in the 1980s, they failed to publish. In fact, I got it on my bookshelf over here. I could pull it right off of my bookshelf to my right here. Finney's Systematic Theology. They stopped it short of the lectures on election and perseverance. Those lectures were there at Oberlin College, available. They're scanned into the website on Finney, but they're not in that book. So naturally, I didn't know nothing about these men at the time. That was over 30 years ago. So I thought that here's what the guy preached, and it sounded good to me. So obviously, I fell under the same delusion as many of you were under about Finney. So Finney, like I said, he was trained in law. He had a very analytical mind and a very sharp intellect. He was able to confound his opponents with his impressive oratory and his imposing persona. If you've ever seen pictures of him, you see the eyes, the stare, you know, the seriousness and somberness of his appearance. See, as a speaker then, he was able to move his audience into fits of deep emotional distress. And he was unparalleled in his time, just like many people can today. That are good at speaking. Look at the politicians. They can get people cheering and stomping and screaming for what? And they're lying. Everything they say coming out of their mouth is a lie. But the same thing here. He says, you know, given back then now, let's understand this is back in the 1850s. This is a long time ago. Given that the Christian world of that day, the professing Christian world of that day, they feared God. They believed in hellfire. Hell was pretty much preached then. You've heard, you know, the hellfire preaching. And they knew that sinning would send them to hell. So he was pretty much a product of his particular generation rather than an incarnation of John the Baptist coming back and preaching repentance and faith and forsake your sins and all those things. In many respects, he was not far off the reservation with his modern Calvinistic proponents, as we'll show. Although they would deny any association with him because of his original sin issue, but they would be forced to agree with him on election, predestination, and perseverance. Piper would be forced to agree with this. John MacArthur and Ed Young and all these guys that we've shown in our videos would be forced to agree with this. So, his lectures show what perseverance is. Perseverance of the saints. Number one is only the elect will be saved. God is handpicked, chosen. Chosen. Who's going to be saved? None of those will be lost. In other words, it's eternal security, as we would call today, OSA. Once saved, always saved. It's perseverance of the saint is just masquerading as once saved, always saved, our eternal security, as people like to call it today. That God only calls the elect with an effectual call of grace. They're called, they're chosen, they're handpicked. It's his choice, not yours. He bends the will of those that are chosen with this effectual call in this divine grace and brings them in. And in Finney's case, well, part of their obedience and their holiness and their perseverance, that's all worked in to their final salvation. That's predetermined. The fact that they're going to obey, be obedient, and everything it says here in the scriptures is all worked in then to their final salvation. It's like he said when John 6:39, he says, "This is the will of the Father who sent me, that all he has given me I shall lose nothing, but should raise them up on the last day." That's the verse he uses in every one of his lectures in John 6:39. That all the Father's given me, I will lose none. He quotes that in every single lecture he does. So, and then man's final destiny is determined from the foundation of the world. He made the choice for you. He effectually called you. It was all part of the plan. Calvinism, 100%. Exactly, you're going to Calvin's institutes, it's exactly, like I say, except for the depravity thing. With Finney, there was still free will involved here. I don't know how there could be free will if he'd predetermined it, but in his mind, it was free will. How he could reject original sin, it's like what I just said, is confounding to me that he wasn't able to see the fallacy of his own reasoning and abandon this thing altogether. How he could believe on one hand that a man is born innocent with the total independent will to choose between right and wrong, able to do that before God, and then at the same time say that the outcome of his salvation is predetermined by election, it blows your mind, doesn't it? But that's what this guy did. You have to be effectively called by this divine grace, chosen beforehand, before the foundation, like Ephesians chapter 1, Romans 8 says. You know, that's the best scriptures he used here. And there's no possibility of ever shipwrecking your faith or turning back or going reprobate or forfeiting your birthright or any of the things the Bible says. Those are all people never say to begin with. You know, and we'll look at some of those scriptures. Okay, Finney said, here's his first quote. I don't have a whole lot of quotes of him, but you can look up the lectures yourself. Finney said, "God has from eternity resolved the salvation of the elect. This can be seen. This we have seen. No one of this number will be lost." He's referring to that verse in John 6:39. "They are given to Christ from eternity as a seed to serve him. Their conversion, their perseverance, final salvation is secured. Their conversion, perseverance, and salvation is secured by the means of the grace of God in Christ prevailing through the gospel so to influence their free will as to bring about the results." That's how he did it, see? You got that? To influence their free will. To bring them in. They don't have no choice. They were predetermined. They were handpicked from the foundation of the world. But there's free will here. How he could not see the fallacy of what he just said there, I have no clue. I wouldn't match my intellect to this man for anything. The man's intellect was far superior to mine. But yet he couldn't see the fallacy of his teaching. Which proves to me that he would never abandon then his Presbyterian roots, which teach this nonsense. So he arrived at this conclusion by piecing together these scriptures, as I've shown, as I said in the beginning of John 6 and Romans 10 and Romans chapter 8, 1 Peter. There's many scriptures that seem to indicate everything's predetermined, everything's pre-elected, and God chose it all beforehand and from the foundation of the world. But see, again, you're implying too much. Because like you said, you go to Hebrews 3:14, is it if you endure, if you take up your cross, if you endure to the end, all those kind of, you got to weigh it against the other scriptures. But all this is the stronghold of modern eternal security teaching, as we've seen. So if it's true that none that are truly saved will ever be lost, as he said, well then, why would the scriptures then constantly warn the chosen and the elect in the scriptures of the possibilities of deception, of going reprobate? Remember what that word reprobate means in the scripture. It's used in Hebrews 6, verse 8. It's used as burned there, where it says, whose end is to be burned. It's the same word reprobate. Same thing used in 1 Corinthians 9:27, where Paul said, I buffet my body so that after I preach to others, I don't become reprobate. I don't become disqualified. I think it's disqualified or castaway in the modern versions. But the word was reprobate in the King James. That's what you'd look up if you want to look up in the Greek lexicons. And it's used all through the scriptures in that manner, meaning completely lost, outcast, burned, as I have said, in Hebrews 6:8 it's translated. And Finney knows that. Finney knows in Hebrews 6:8 that word was translated burned, whose end is to be burned. He was talking about the people that fall away. It's impossible to renew them again to repentance. They were partakers of the Holy Spirit. They had tasted the good word to come, the age of the come. You've read that for Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. We'll go down to verse 8, and it gives you the illustration of what happens to those people. If they don't repent, the ground then becomes parched and useless, whose end is to be burned. Burned. That word's reprobated. So you see, to Finney, you couldn't become reprobated. You can't forfeit the kingdom. So, if you grant then that the language of election, of foreknowledge and predestination is used in the scriptures, that God knows the final outcome of every human soul that is born, how does that bind him then to that outcome that he decides for them? I don't think it does. I think that's way off base. See, within this divine plan, the scriptures show that God can change his mind according to the choices that men make in relationship to degrees of God. He's not bound by any absolute outcome to any given situation or individual. Of course, he can alter time, he can stop the clock, he can do whatever he wants. But Scripture shows in what manner he works. See, if a person like Paul or Peter or anybody in the Scriptures is predestined according to the foreknowledge of God, as we can go to 1 Peter 1:2, and it reads in that manner, then their final salvation is still contingent on their obedience and endurance to the end. But to Finney, of course, that's a foregone conclusion. But yet, why would there be constant warnings? If it was a foregone conclusion, why would Peter and Paul both warn people of the possibility, like going reprobate, Paul, as Paul warned, and falling into the error of the wicked, as Peter warned in 2 Peter 3:17. You don't fall from your steadfastness into the error of the wicked. You fall from your steadfast faith. Just like Romans 2:7 said, that's how you get in. He who continues. Continuance and steadfast to the end. See, that the fact that, again, in John 5:24, it talks about you've passed from death unto life because you've believed. In other words, Finney also, in this, believed in the eternal now doctrine of Augustine, the Augustinian doctrine of eternal now, meaning that God exists outside of eternity, and that once you exercise faith, once you have that moment of faith, then it's a done deal. You might as well be there. Isn't that exactly what's said today by people like Luther and Ed Young? And they act like you're already in heaven. It's a done deal. See, you make your arrangement, as a lot of these guys like to say. And it's done deal. See, because you've believed once, then the arrangement is made. He says, you're there already. But given within the parameter, you know, the scriptures are given to us within the parameters of time in the present tense, which shows clearly in the Greek. Just like passages in Titus 3:7, where it says, having been justified by his grace we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. That's how you would translate that into modern English. You might become heirs according. Why? Because it's in that tense that it's not completed yet. Jesus spoke in this manner throughout the Gospels, saying in John 6:24, he who is now believing. The Greek tense denotes, again, and Finney knew this, the Greek tense denotes continued and repeated action in order to attain the outcome. Continued and repeated action in order to retain the outcome. And all these Greek scholars, so-called Greek scholars, know that. It's not hidden. You can find these things out very easily. God is not addressing man from the eternal now or outside of time. This teaching has led people like Finney and others into false hopes because they profess this nominal faith that they were elected and all, and they hope against hope that they're saved, but they really have no witness. They have no change in their life. Prophet Jeremiah really points this out, that God reacts in the parameters of time in Jeremiah 32:35, where the people were offering their children in the sacrificial fires of Baal. And God proclaimed through Jeremiah, he says, I did not command them to do this, nor did it come into my mind that they should do this abomination. Here God's saying it didn't even cross his mind that the people would do such a thing. Now whether you want to argue or not that God foreknew what they were going to do, it really makes no difference to the fact what it says here, and it shows clearly that he acts in accordance with men's decisions, and outcomes can vary. Just like in Nineveh when they preached to the people. Maybe God will relent. Remember that the king said? They repented. He didn't know it was a done deal. He couldn't see the future. But he knew that God would turn from his fierce wrath if the people fell in and repented before him. In Exodus chapter, there's all kinds of these, but I just picked a couple. In Exodus 32, verses 31 through 35, Moses in the wilderness. You've seen this in all the movies about Moses, when they had fashioned the golden image. It's called a golden god in Scripture, not necessarily a calf. Moses pleaded with God to spare them when he went back to the mountain and prayed. He says, pray that blot my name out instead. So God changed his mind. He was going to destroy the whole nation. But he changed his mind. He curbed his fierce wrath, punished only the evildoers. So again, because why? Because of what Moses intervened, his faith. There's several more instances of this throughout the Old Testament, dealing with man within the parameters of time, showing that he is not bound to any particular outcome, but acts on the contingency of man's choice in many cases. Of course, he can override man's choice if he wants to. Of course he can do those things. Bring forth the Messiah. Bring forth the nation of Israel. When he returns to the earth. All those kind of things. Those things are predetermined. Those things can't be altered. So Finney said, again, next quote by Finney. This grace I regard as vouchsafed to me. In other words, safe. It's an old word. To me, is the covenant of grace as the reward of Christ's obedience and death. It is pledged to secure the salvation of those whom the Father from eternity has given to the Son. Back to that John 6:39 verse. He refers to that everywhere. The Holy Spirit is given to them to secure their salvation, and I have no exception that any others will ever be saved. In other words, nobody else but the elect will be saved. It's impossible. He makes that perfectly clear in those lectures. But these, every one of them, will be surely saved. There is and there can be no hope for any others. Others are able to repent, but they will not. Again, that's his free will thing. See, they can repent. They could decide to try to follow God, but God didn't choose them. Many are called, few are chosen. Remember, Scripture said that. That's the Scripture he would use there. Others might be saved if they would believe and comply with the conditions of salvation, but they can't. Man, what a tyrannical, monstrous God that depicts before mankind. No wonder there have been wars and inquisitions and crusades and all the other things throughout history. With that view and concept of a God that rules over his creation, and he's going to throw babies into hell if he wants to, and most of the created people that he died for, made propitiation for the sins of the whole world, John said he did. But no, not these guys, only the elect. because he couldn't have died for somebody that's never going to be saved. That wouldn't have been right. That would insult his sovereignty. I don't have anything to do with God's sovereignty. So by necessity then, Finney's got to teach these two things. That the truly elect can never be lost, which we pointed out. Number two, that no New Testament passage anywhere in the Bible, in the New Testament, teaches that a true saint can fall into eternal ruin. Now here's where it gets sticky. Here's where he's willing to do anything with the scriptures to prove his point. So the doctrine then becomes the perfect cop-out, as I would call it. If you endure in obedience and holiness to the end, you were among the elect, and your salvation was secure from the foundation of the world. We just read that. If you go reprobate or shipwreck or fall away or turn aside or anything, any of the other things the scripture warns about, swerve into the error of the wicked, be deceived by the strong delusion, then you weren't elect to begin with. You were never saved. And no matter how much you want to include free choice here, there is no free choice. Because you end up back to square one with John Calvin. That only the elect, he chooses, he makes the decision, God decides who's saved and who isn't. Now with Finney, your election meant that you would indeed persevere in holiness if you were truly elected. See, that would be the evidence of that, would be that you obey God, live above sin, endure to the end in holiness. Your choice to do so then, as I read, was worked into the structure of your election, of your salvation. The call, the grace to give you the obedience to do so, it had nothing to do with anything you did. But he'll say, well, your free will chose that. God allowed your free will. It doesn't make sense. It's all predetermined. You respond to the degree that God's effectual calling is exerted over your will to bring about that obedience and endurance in faith that is necessary to work out your salvation. So, let's move into some more doublespeak here. That's exactly what this is. Finney said, it's a longer quote, he said, the saints convert themselves in the sense that they turn or yield when drawn. Again, he has to have free will there. Until over-persuaded by the Holy Spirit, God converts them in the sense that he effectively draws and persuades them. Well, God does it for them. Okay. They turn themselves in the sense that they're turning in their own act. God turns them in the sense that he induces or produces their turning. So who did it? You or God? The same is true of their whole course of their obedience of life. The saints keep themselves in the sense that all their obedience is their own, and their piety consists of their own voluntary obedience. It sounds good, see? That sounds good, your voluntary obedience. But God keeps them in the sense that in every incident, in every moment of obedience, he persuades and enlightens and draws them so much as secure their voluntary obedience. That is, he draws and they follow. In other words, he does it for them. Just like, exactly like Piper teaches. Exactly the same thing. That it's essential that you persevere. It's essential that you have works. That you have holiness. But the thing is, you trust that it's already done. It's already predetermined. That's exactly the same teaching. There's no different. He persuades and they yield to his persuasions. He works in them to will and to do, and they will do. God always anticipates all their holy exercises and persuades them to put them forth. To do them. This is so abundantly taught in the Bible as to quote scripture to prove it would be a waste of time. Of course, in that, I'd say you can prove anything in the scriptures. The saints are only said to be converted, but also sanctified and kept. Now the scripture says, he says they keep themselves, but then he keeps them. Now the scripture says, keep yourself pure. Keep yourself in the love of God, it says in Jude. Keep yourself from idols, John tells him in 1 John 5. It doesn't sound like he says, well, God's going to keep you from idols. It says, keep yourself those things. Keep yourself pure, he tells Timothy in 1 Timothy 5. That's the only thing that makes sense, that it's of your free volition, your will, to do so. Not that God has to bend your will, compel you, overcome you, predetermine that you're going to do it. That does not make sense. So in other words, you don't have to obey from your heart, like Romans 6:17 says. He would say the same thing Piper says there, that he obeyed for you. That's what you're thanking God for in that verse, that he obeyed for you. even though it says you obeyed from your heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered, having been set free from sin, became a slave of righteousness. No, he did it for you. You expect that God will persuade you in some manner then to follow him, obey him, rather than the obedience itself being the principle of the faith. See, that's the problem with this. See, the principle behind faith is obedience. It's action. Surely he's saying that the result is action. But since God is doing it, he's ordained it, he's elected and predestinated, predetermined the whole thing, it's not essential. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't matter to the outcome of your salvation. Argue this until you're blue in the face and run out of breath with me. It boils down to the same thing. If God brings about the outcome, and his election cannot be altered, as we've already shown you, then man's choice is irrelevant. It doesn't count. God made the choice. What man does or does not do makes no difference with the outcome of reaching the conclusion. So we go right back to John MacArthur and Piper and what them guys teach. That's the reason they teach what they teach. That teaching has culminated into this mess we got today. That it doesn't John MacArthur even say, it doesn't matter what you do or don't do or add or take away or commend yourself. Or it doesn't make any difference because it's all been done. You're in or you're not in. See, this is why Finney would have to go to great lengths to explain away the scriptures and to prove that no true saint ever could or ever will fall into eternal ruin. Here he shows his true colors as a closet Calvinist. Remember, when we proceed with this, these arguments are presented in the manner, I'm not trying to argue OSA or prove any doctrinal point here as we've done in the past. All I'm showing you is how Finney was willing to manipulate the scriptures to prove his point, which was a lie. Now in 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 12 through 22, I'll post these notes on the website and you can go over them then yourself. There's much here. We may even have to do this in two parts. Now he talks about this and he shows that these people were never saved to begin with. To read all this is really not relevant to the discussion. But if he goes up through, have two or three paragraphs here to prove that the people that Peter's talking about in 2 Peter 2, verses 12 through 22, were never in with. You know, they were entangled. They were, you know, they escaped the pollutions of the world. They had the knowledge. They were exposed to the way of righteousness. But when they returned to their own vomit as a pig or a dog, it proved then that they were never of the new nature. They were always a pig or a dog. So that proves then that they were still a sow, they were still a dog. Their nature hadn't changed. They weren't born again. It's the same lie everybody uses. Everybody. So the apostle, then he's saying, returning to their former way, experienced no radical change in their contrary to that. So they were hypocrites, in other words. The whole chapter talking about nothing, a bunch of hypocrites in chapter 2. Standard argument of eternal security preachers all over the planet today, if you've ever debated this issue. Everybody's a hypocrite, never saved to begin with. Same argument in Hebrews 6, Hebrews 10, the same thing. They affirm that Hebrews 6, 4 through 6, that the people in question had fallen away. And, of course, they use the if there, like the King James Version. It doesn't really say if. It says having fallen away. And even though they were partakers of the Holy Spirit, they weren't really partakers of the Holy Spirit. They'll even say, well, there's no scripture to denote that any of those people were real saints. There isn't. In Hebrews 10, being illuminated with enlightened. Used in Ephesians in reference to those that had their eyes enlightened and opened. So they're lying there to you there. So these words speak of those genuinely saved elsewhere in scripture, and these people know it, but they're misleading you to say, well, no, perhaps they don't. So he does the same thing and says, suggesting that the apostle is addressing only hypocrites. But why would he do that? Why would that be addressed only to hypocrites? Or people never say to begin? It doesn't make any sense. To what purpose are warnings issued to somebody that's already condemned in their sins, that never repent? The warning's already there. If he had merely cowardly, as Finney says, to the Christian life, then why does he say in verse 20, escaped indeed? Now it says they clean escaped, and some of them are, some of the others use different translation. But the word, if you look up at verse 20, they have escaped indeed from those that live in error, is what it says, literally. exact expression used in John 8:31, where the Son sets you free, you are free indeed, that the Lord uses. Yeah? Finney, more than anybody. The apostle speaking to people that had made shipwreck of their faith, just like Paul said in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 18 and 20, of those men that had shipwrecked their faith. Is showing clearly a genuine saint that did fall into eternal ruin through neglect and sin. I know you can piece together many passages to imply that the elect will never be lost and make it sound that way. Just like they speak real good and they smooth their words, great swelling words of emptiness, just like Peter calls them. But you got to compare Scripture with Scripture, with the, you know, and find what the truth is saying. See, we don't deny that there's election in the sense that God foreknows the actions of individuals. I'm not denying that. We do affirm, however, that he's not bound to a particular outcome because of that. Man has a choice, and that choice determines his ultimate destination of his soul. Not God making the choice for him from the foundation of the world. From the foundation of the world, God determined that he would have a holy people apart, serving him in the image of his Son. That's what those scriptures mean. The only way they make any sense compared to these other scriptures. The things you have to do and the warnings you have to abide and beware of. That's what those scriptures must mean in Ephesians chapter 1 and Romans chapter 8. That he predetermined from the foundation of the world that he would have a holy people that would serve him. Who would the chosen be? The called and the chosen. Those who obey him in holiness and endure to the end. Those are the called and the chosen. It's the only thing that makes sense. So again, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Finney asserts that, again, these people mentioned by Moses. In 1 Corinthians 10, verses 1 through 13, where he gives the story of the people in the wilderness and shows that that was examples to us of what you shouldn't be doing because you'll fall into a ruin like they did. So he shows how they were baptized into Moses, but they weren't really baptized. That they partook of the spiritual food and drink, but they really didn't understand what they were doing. And, you know, They were following, but they really weren't following. So they weren't really regenerate, you know, in their baptism through the Red Sea, which everybody uses as the illustration of baptism, you know, especially in the sanctification end of the church. It doesn't apply to anything because they didn't really understand the consequences of all these things. So in other words, none of them were saved, the ones that fell into eternal ruin. Same arguments. Again, the same old worn-out arguments been being used for 200-300 years. Nobody was a real Christian. People of Israel coming out of Egypt, they didn't really get delivered. So why warned? Moses should have been preaching repentance to them like John the Baptist, if none of them were saved to begin with. Nowhere in the New Testament is it taken up anywhere by the apostles, nor did any of the apostles concern themselves with somebody that was never saved to begin with. Even the guy in 1 Corinthians 5, verses 1 through 5, was not numbered among the never saved to begin with. Paul never suggests anywhere that that man was a hypocrite or never saved to begin with. He simply exposes the man's sin and turns him over to punishment. That's all he does. He doesn't say, I knew this guy was never saved to begin with. Look what he's doing. What a reprobate. No, he never suggests that. See, Finney would have to say that such passages then as 1 Corinthians 6, 9, and 10, and Galatians 5, 19 through 21, that list the sins that are going to keep you out of the kingdom, doesn't apply to real Christians. Why? Well, they don't apply to David, did they? David committed those sins, adultery and murder, and it didn't disqualify him from the kingdom. So how can it disqualify you from the kingdom? How can he say you're reprobate because you didn't endure? And you're only justified as far as you obey if David did those things. How does he know your heart is not a heart after God? See, you can't judge that way. You can't judge a person's heart. You can only judge their fruit. You know them by their fruits, Jesus said. So if those sins are not going to keep anybody out of the kingdom, they have to be written in only to the lost that are already out of the kingdom. Again. So observe what he says about the 1 Corinthians 10 passage. They were baptized into Moses, but they were only introduced to the covenant. Again, I didn't read it all, but you can read it when I post the notes. They partook of the spiritual bread and water, but they didn't understand what it meant. Does the apostle affirm any of these things? No. He doesn't. This is all conjecture. Finney, by conjecture, says, well, this is the reason. See, they didn't understand. They didn't, they partook, but they, you know, that's conjecture, okay? That's what that's called. The fact that the Lord was displeased with many of them is the warning in the Scripture. Not to show that they were never saved to begin with. That's ludicrous. What good would an example be to the genuine believers to which this is written in Corinth if these people were non-elect with no possibility of ever being saved? They weren't called and chosen. If anybody was called and chosen, it was the Israelites in Egypt, right? The sons of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Come on. The illustration in this passage is that every soul is given the same opportunity to endure or not endure. This is never intended for us to decide between who's saved and who isn't. That's pure conjecture. Only can know by their fruits, by what they produce. If David was never lost, as Finney affirms in his lectures, well, then how can we know anybody's ever lost if they fall into child molestation or murder or whatever it is? We can't. So it would suggest then that passages like Romans 11, 17 through 23, you know, doesn't mean what it says, where you can be cut off if you don't endure. But this passage, again, is an allusion to what Paul's talking about in 1 Corinthians 10. Paul warns believers that branches were broken off, that others might be grafted in, but don't boast about it, because God did not spare the natural branches, the people in 1 Corinthians 10. He didn't spare them when they sinned. He's not going to spare you either. So note the goodness and the severity of God on those who fell. People in the wilderness fell. He shows the example with Moses. Severity, but towards you, goodness, if you continue in his goodness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off. And then it goes on to say in the very next verse, in 24, that he can graft them in again if they come back to repentance. I don't know how much more clear you could be that this is nonsense than that Romans 11 passage. I don't see where they dealt with that passage much, but I brought that in because it compares so well with 1 Corinthians 10. So again, to what purpose would this election be if he cut off a vast number of the people spoken of in Scripture that could never be saved to begin with, like most of those people coming out of Israel, the millions perhaps that there were? It'd be none whatsoever. There would be no warning, no example. Finney would indeed explain this away, as he's done all the other, but it doesn't make any difference. The truth speaks for itself. See, Finney is the perfectly in line with the present-day eternal security preachers. He's rejected their doctrine of original sin, yeah, but in such a way that it really doesn't matter. You still don't have a choice, and they'd like that. His arguments assert that they're in exact agreement with his. The fact that Paul said they can shipwreck your faith in 1 Timothy 1, they were never saved. They was never on the ship. Those who fell into reproach and the snare of the devil in 1 Timothy 2, 6, and 7, they were phonies too. Anybody who turned aside after Satan, as it speaks of in 1 Timothy 5, 12 through 15, they never followed. So they never followed Christ to begin with. Judas was never saved to begin with, and his calling and sending out with the 12 and endued with the powers from on high, he was never saved. King David was not in a state of reprobation for that 9 months after he committed the sins of adultery and murder, and Saul was never saved to begin with, even though he was anointed and handpicked by God to be king and had the Spirit of God. Even though it's repeatedly said in the Scriptures that if you do these things, you will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So you can cast all that out the window because of Romans chapter 8. See, Finney said that the 8th chapter of Romans settles the question forever. Well, it does in most of these guys. Their grounds of hope, and that's it. See, you're glorified, you're just, again, from the eternal now, see, you're already called, predestined, conformed, justified, glorified. You're there already. That's the passage they like to use here. But again, this is speaking of what God has predetermined ahead of time. In Romans 8:28, those whom he foreknew, he did predestine to be conformed to the image of his Son. Those are the ones he determined from the foundation of the world to be conformed to that image, the ones that would obey and follow him. through their free choice, not the choice that God made for them. That's the reason the language that's used here. Otherwise, it doesn't fit in with anything else that we've just talked about in the scriptures. It totally contradicts it. So, we move on with this. As Finney goes through, he says, this is your only grounds of hope, and they'd never be lost. So here the question is settled. Because Paul makes these assertions in Romans chapter 8, nothing in the scriptures that we went over, or will go over, means that a real saint can be cut off or cast away or go reprobate or shipwreck. None of those things mean anything. That's all people never say to begin with, and he can prove it. So the error in understanding is who is being addressed here and why. Who are the called and chosen, as I said before? Those who obey Christ. Was not the atonement made for the whole world, the sins of the whole world? In 1 John 2:1. That's what John said. He didn't talk about the elect in that passage. I know they always say, well, it's the elect, you know, like in the 2 Peter passage, where he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance and salvation. No, only the elect is what it really means. Again, conjecture. It doesn't say that. But they put that in by conjecture. He says, he foreknew and he predestined them to be conformed, as I pointed out, through repentance real faith. So if you come in through repentance and real faith, as we've pointed out in many of our lectures before, that you have a strong reason for hope and final salvation. By patient continuance in doing good, you inherit the kingdom. By patient continuance in doing good, you seek for all glory and honor and immortality, you inherit eternal life. Yeah, you have a strong reason for hope, and that's what Paul had done. I fought the good fight. I kept the faith. I finished the race. He had a strong hope in Christ. And anybody that would follow his example, as he told them time and time and time again to do so, as a pattern to all the churches, not the chief of sinners, not a guy sinning every day in thought, word, and deed, like these maniacs say, but a man, a saint of God, then you will have this same hope, this same anchor to the soul, as he says in Hebrews. So, we have become partakers of Christ if we hold our confidence steadfast to the end. Hold fast. That's the words used there. I know it doesn't use that word in the King James Bible, but that's the word that's used in that passage. Same word Jesus uses. He that hold. Keep. Hold. Same thing. He that keeps my words. That means holds fast to my words. Continues to do so. Continued in repeated action, like I pointed out before. That's the tense that it's in. Not the eternal now. Now you did it once and it's done. No. It has to be continued. So in this manner, then, everything, Romans 8, and all these scriptures line up, and it removes us from the burden of explaining away these things or trying to prove something you can't prove, and then throwing conjecture into the mix and turning out to be a fool at the end of it because of what you did to the scriptures. But this is what's preached today, and it promotes lawless behavior in the church. And Finney is at least guilty of the inevitable outcome of this teaching on the whole of the Christian church. Instead of refuting these awful doctrines, he stands in agreement with people like Spurgeon and Moody and Pink and Piper and MacArthur and all the rest of them. And I just named the guys from his century. They together laid the foundation of the come in your sins message that we see today in the abundance of emails that we keep getting. The cheap and easy salvation of confess and receive instead of repent and obey. All these men stressed obedience and holiness, those men of the past that are dead, just like Finney did. But everything's predetermined and the souls of men are elected, so none of that obedience to God is of any consequence. Okay? None of it. Because the elect will obey. Otherwise, you weren't elect. So Finney believed that he believed it this way, that Hebrews 3:14 passage. He believed that if you are saved, you will endure. Not if you endure, you will be saved. And it's exactly the way you've probably heard that, those of you that aren't blinded by this lie to begin with. See, if you're saved, you'll endure. That's what Piper thinks that means, and all the rest of them, and Finney, and Spurgeon, and Moody, and all the rest of them. But the scripture says, if you endure, you're saved. It's like, if you keep yourself pure, if you keep yourself in the love of God. Again, by what? By predetermined? Because he did it for you? And certainly grace is the power of godliness and self-control as stated in the scriptures. But to choose for you just blows away the whole gospel. So if you want to satisfy your curiosity about these things, then I would beseech you to read those lectures. Study this again. I'll post these notes on the website. And you can go over this again and remove any doubt in your mind about what he taught. And it was his own special version of eternal security, which places him directly in the camp with the modern gospel of come in your sins. Now, I know that Finney would be vehemently opposed to this cheap and easy gospel of today, of people living in adultery and molestation. He'd thunder against those things. Finney and Spurgeon and all those guys would from that century, given the fact that hellfire and the fear of God was more prevalent in society back then. But they still preached this nonsense, and it laid the foundation for this lawlessness that we're facing now in your church. That no matter what side of the fence you're on, either on everything's predetermined, or over here the holiness that says they reject this stuff, but yet they still preach come in your sins. And we've proved that beyond any shadow of a doubt. See, to them, you still come in your sins. It doesn't make any difference. You come, you confess, you receive, God cleans you up later. See, it's the same gospel, no matter how you cut it. And that's what Finney preached, and that's what all these men preach. And we just wanted to show you that. So go over these things again. Look at these lecture notes, and look at the lectures of Finney for your own self, and you'll begin to understand what we're talking about.
I don't know how to make it any more plain. I'm just crying out from my heart to you. The Lord's showing me these things, and He'll show you. I'm nothing special. I'm nobody. I am nobody. I'm unknown but well known, like Paul says. I'm nobody in this world. The dung of the earth. And I'm giving you the Word of God. False teachers, they have the platform. They control the flow of money. They control the schools, the book publishing companies, the radio stations, the TV stations, everything. They control it all. That's all part of the judgment that's come upon the church. Because they won't receive a love of the truth, because they've been deceived and being deceived, they've listened to false teachers and to the lying spirits, so they have the platform. They own the platform. We can't even get in the door.